Okay, let's go to the Bible. Genesis chapter 6, verse 22. Y'all gonna help me preach? Okay, all right, all right. Genesis chapter 6, we're gonna read verse 22. And Noah did everything just as God commanded him. Flip the track. And Noah did everything just as God commanded him. I want to preach this morning the builder's anointing. The builder's anointing. And Noah did what, church? Everything. Who said that? That was nice and strong. I like, there you go, Minister T. And Noah did everything just as God commanded. We're going to preach this morning the builder's anointing. Father, we thank you and we praise you because your word is a lamp unto our feet. It is a light unto our path. So, Father, we want you to speak now. The words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. Let the saints be edified. Let you be glorified. Let hell be horrified. In Jesus' name we pray. We say it is so, and it will not be reversed. In Jesus' name. You can have your seats. I want to teach this morning with the premise of callings and assignments just for the next maybe about 20 minutes. I want to talk to you today specifically about callings and assignments, especially for those of you who you know that you are behind schedule in something that you are supposed to be doing. You have uncertainty in that area about accepting the assignment, whether it is because of a personal perspective, a viewpoint in your life, or even the resources that you may not have. I want to check the room real quick, and I want to make sure that we're all on the same page, that everyone recognizes that every single one of us, every one of us, has a calling, and every single one of us has a purpose. Are we all on the same page there? And I tell you all this on many Sundays, you've heard me say to you that God never creates anything without it having a purpose. There are no mistakes in God. It does not matter how you came into this earth. There are no mistakes in God, and there are no surprises in God. And so when he acknowledges that you, by your first name, are going to enter into this world, one, he allows it, and then two, he designates an assignment specifically for you. Are y'all with me this morning? Specifically for you. And so what becomes our responsibility is to not only, one, through leadership, through mentorship, through prayer, through the word of God, to identify that assignment. The second thing we must do is accept the assignment. And the truth is that more of us have problem accepting the assignment than we do acknowledging it. Because there are many of us in this room who we already know what God is calling us to. The struggle is the acceptance of that thing. And so it is important for us as believers to now maturely begin to move into place where we accept all that God wants us to be. And I will give you the benefit of the doubt this morning, because it is true that based upon whether it is parenting, whether it is things that you came across in relationships, that it is very possible that the enemy will place people in your life to make you doubt who he has really called you to be. And many of those things, they become seeds that are rooted inside of us. And when assignment rises up, we are often reminded of that narrative. So you may have been called to speak or to minister to somebody, but that seed of doubt in your accent or the way that you talk will rise up, and you will question whether or not the assignment is really for you. I'm not talking to anybody in the room today. And so I want to talk to those of you that are in, have been, and may be in that place, because here is the next thing that you must understand, that assignments have the propensity to change based upon where you are in life. that you may not have the same assignment now that you had in your teenage years or your 20s or your 30s, that based upon what God needs in the earth in the present time, he may shift where he needs you in the present time. And it is your responsibility, watch this church, to move with the assignment of God even when it is uncomfortable. Is there anybody in the room who knows that God has a sense of humor because he will often call you to the very thing you don't want to do? So the Bible teaches us throughout about assignment, and I want to encourage you all this morning. You know that God has put something in your spirit. You know that you are apprehensive about doing it. You have tried it and you've been discouraged before. This message is for you. And the Bible introduces us to Noah. Noah, he is the perfect illustration of faith and obedience. Everybody say faith, and everybody say obedience. Come on, make me feel like I'm at Megafest. Say faith. That's it, church, and obedience. He is a resemblance of this, particularly when it relates to doing something that has never been done before. Because here is the next thing that prophetically many of you need to receive, is that what God is going to call you to in this season, it won't just be new to you, it'll be new to the world. Preach, apostle. You are going to be called to something that won't just be out of your skill set. It'll be something that the world has never seen. And that is why many times we are delayed, because when God gives us an assignment, we are looking for a blueprint, and there is no blueprint. You are the blueprint. Touch somebody, say, you are the blueprint. So we will delay and we will get discouraged because we only feel comfortable when we can see a mirror of what we've been called to. But what do you do when you're the only one God has called to it? What do you do when there is no predecessor, there is no before you? It begins with you. Touch your neighbor, tell them it begins with you. And that is what God is calling for in the season. Watch this for three of you that have talked back to me, because I believe that we have enough replicas already. We've got enough people following the same module, doing the same thing, and it is becoming tired. God wants to raise up. Too early, apostle, you said you were going to teach, man. God wants to raise up. He wants to raise up people who are not afraid to do what is unconventional. And can I tell you, this is the problem with the church. Because as the Spirit of the Lord is moving in this new season, there are going to be things that he does that are going to be uncomfortable for the religious-minded church. And if we do not begin to broaden our mindset, our mind, to accept the new thing that God is doing, we will find ourselves living in the past. So Noah is an example of this. When we approach this story, the Bible says, as overseers so eloquently shared with us, that Noah is called on assignment. God says, I'm going to wipe the earth clean. He says, because I'm at the point where I regret even making man. He's at this point. And he decides that he's going to wipe the earth clean. Come on, Sunday school students, you know this story. But in the midst of all the unrighteousness, church, there is one who decided that he was not going to go with the pack. There was one who said that no matter what people are doing, I am going to live righteously. There was one, touch somebody, say there's one, who said that although the whole world has turned wicked, he said, I'm going to live for the Lord. He said, I'm going to live righteously. Somebody say righteously. Oh, God, feel my wheels turning now. He said righteous. That word righteous, it comes from the Greek word dikaiosune. Come on, you sound real smart. Say dikaiosune. Dikaiosune is the word for righteousness in the Greek. It means this, Elder Ingram, you'll like this. It means living in all relationship with God. It means living in all relationship with God. It comes and stems from the Greek word dikaios, meaning, watch this, church. Oh, this is good. Meaning equity of character. Oh, I'm teaching better than y'all talking today. Righteousness, dikaiosune. Say dikaiosune. Come on, come on. Say it in your neighbor's face like you got your Greek degree. Come on, say dikaiosune. It means equity of character. What is character? Character is the mental or the moral qualities that are distinctive to an individual. In essence, what the word says is Moses was a man of good character. And one thing that we see in this world now more than ever is a lack of character. Oh, my God. Oh, we got great skills and we got great gifts and we got great talents, but we are seeing a lack of character. We are living in a world, church, where people are justifying their negative actions, their lack of integrity, and their void of accountability and dressing it up in false humility. Y'all ain't talking to me in here. I said we are living in a world, God have mercy, where people are justifying their negative actions, justifying their lack of integrity, justifying their void of accountability, and they are dressing it up in false humility. In essence, they are always the victim. But they lack integrity. They lack accountability. And if I can tell you today, what's going to get you into heaven is not your title. What's going to get you into heaven, is not your degree. What's going to get you into heaven is your dikaiosune, your character. The way you live while you are on this earth. Watch this. Even when the doors are closed and the lights are off. Tell somebody, say, you got to live this thing all the time. Come on, you got to live this thing, not just Sunday from 10:15 to 1:30. You got to live this thing all the time. We think that righteousness is a look. We think that righteousness is perfection, but righteousness is the fabric of your character. It's what you do when nobody's looking. It's what you say when nobody else can hear you. It's what you think that nobody else can understand or see. It is your righteousness. And the Bible said that we ought to do what? We ought to hunger and thirst after dikaiosune. After the equity of our character. Which means every day I wake up, I'm trying to be the best me. Every day I wake up, I'm striving to live in all equity with God. And so because of this, Noah seemed weird, Elder Mary. He seemed weird. He stood out from the rest. He didn't go along with the culture. He didn't conform to what was going on. It is what we see today because now we're in this culture. Come on, you'll help me, mother. You'll help me. We're living in this culture where we want this thing that has become out of control. It's a thing we call balance. I want to be balanced. I don't just want to be all church. I want to have a little bit of church, and then I want to have my Henny on the weekend. Balance. Yeah. I want to have my anointing oil, and I want to have my crystals. Balance. I need balance. Yeah. I'll do church two Sundays, and then I need a vacation. Balance. We are living under this wrong pretense, and it is tainting our dikaiosune. It's tainting our character because now we've got the influence of the world and the influence of the word. But the Bible that I read says, choose ye this day whom you will serve. And so this is who Noah is. He was a man of character. He was a man of character. And what you must understand for my note takers is that it is your character. I need all distractions to cease. It is your character that disqualifies you. It is your character that qualifies you. Somebody say it's your character that qualifies you. So the problem with man today is we are chasing skill. We are chasing accolades, but we have no character. I need somebody to help me there. Thank you. But it is the character of a person that does what? Opens doors. Y'all focus on me. It's the character of a person that opens doors. Look at your neighbor, say neighbor. Come on, look at your neighbor, say neighbor. That was this side. I need this side. Tell them if you want doors to open for you, Tell him you got to focus on your character. Ask him, say, who are you when nobody is around? Who are you? Who are you when nobody is looking at you? Who are you in your thought process? Moses was a man of character. And so your character is not in your degree, it's in how you treat people. Now, I'm not saying degrees aren't necessary because we need to be educated, but when you get to heaven, he's not going to say, show me how many masters you have. He's going to say, did you go to them and say, I'm sorry? They don't like that. They don't like that kind of preaching. They wanted houses, cars, and lands this morning. So Moses, I'm trying to get you to understand how you get the anointing to build. Because many of us, we are the biggest frustration in what we're trying to build. So the character of a person opens doors. So Noah is called not because of his skill. He's called because of his dikaiosune, the equity of his character. But he just did that for me. I'm sorry. It just makes me feel good. Here's what you must understand. That anytime you are called, the calling comes with pressure. Can we talk about that pressure? Now you may feel disqualified because in your mind, what you've been taught is that a calling means that you've got a microphone, you've got a title, you've got a platform. But no, you may be called right in your home, right in your job, right in your friend circle. And anything that God ever calls you to, there will be pressure. Many of you are saying, I know, Apostle, that's why I haven't said yes. Because there is a pressure that comes with it. That's why I will never understand, Minister Gabe, why people run to this. Why people seek after this. Can I tell y'all something and y'all tell your friends? This is not a career choice. This is not an aspire to be. This is a call to be. Because as much as you are aspired to it, you will be despired to it. I don't know if that's a word, but it's a word today. When you realize everything that you've got to deal with. See, we make this look good on Sunday. Look good in my green suit. Don't I look good? Look good with the mic in my hand. Got my fancy glasses on and my laptop. It looks real good, don't it? Until you got to deal with the calls during the week. Till you got to deal with the, I think we should do this, but I think we should do this. Tell somebody, this comes with pressure. Anytime you're called to something, it's going to come with pressure. Now this is not for the Sunday Christians where you hear today and then you cuss tomorrow. I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to those of you that are really trying to live this thing. Tell somebody, I'm really trying to live this. And it seems like the more I'm trying to live it, the more pressure I come up against. Is that anybody's testimony? It seems like the closer I get to really walking circumspectly with the word of God, it seems like the more pressure I'm under. Prophesy to your neighbor and tell them that means you're closer than you've ever been. I'm talking to those of you who have really made up your mind that I want to live for God. Now, part of that living, if I can teach very quickly, is that you must take up the assignment that God has put on your life. Now, the other part of that that's hard, Sister Tanya, is because assignments come with sacrifice. Oh, man. They come with sacrifice. And many of the times that sacrifice is that you've got to move away from the pack. You've got to move away from your good girlfriends. You got to move away from that man who you love so much and just does everything the way you like it. You got to move away from some of that stuff. Don't y'all get nervous. Y'all come closer to me. You got to move away from that stuff. And that is a problem. And that is why many of us live a life that is unfulfilled, because we are somewhere in between knowing what he called us to and the sacrifice to be who he wants us to be. See, you cannot get to heaven just knowing what he wanted you to do. You've got to fulfill the will of the Lord in your life, which means that you've got to be separated. You've got to be transformed and not conformed. Are y'all with me this morning? And so this is for those of you that say, I am determined to live for God. That pressure, overseer, oh God, it can be so hard because every day there are temptations. God, can I be honest with y'all and y'all not kick me out of the church? Oh God, there are temptations because if I told you the truth, if I didn't make up who I wanted to be in God, there's about three other me's I would love to be. I know y'all don't like that. Y'all don't like that kind of talk because you came out speaking in tongues. I know you did. I know you did. You sleep in a prayer shawl. Understood. But there are some of us where we've had to make a decision that the me I want to be, I can't be. Because the calling means more than the fulfillment of my flesh. That's what Paul was dealing with. He said, there's a war inside of me. He said, the good that I want to do, I'm broken. I don't understand how I don't do it. Because in every single one of you, there is a war between who you want to be and who God needs you to be. And you've got to ask yourself, is my want more important than his need? This is what the Bible says when he says, there shall be no other God before me. Because for many of us, when we put our own desire above that of the will of God, we have made an idol out of that thing. Oh, my Savior. I'm going to give you something real simple just so you can get it. And then three of you will smile at me so the rest that are looking at me with daggers won't make me feel uncomfortable in this church. Is that all right? Amen. When you wake up in the morning and say, I'd rather sleep in than go to worship, you have made an idol. I told you, Sister Todd, thank you for smiling at me. Sister, these are the little idols that we make. Come on. Can somebody help? I need my minister just to help me. Have my back this morning. So Noah, he was a righteous man. He had equity. He had the kaiosune. He had the equity of character in everything that he did. But the assignment came with pressure because he had to accept doing something that had never been done before. Prophesy to your neighbor. Tell him you're getting ready to do something that's never been done before. Come on, tell him. Say, you're getting ready to do something that has never been done before. Nobody has opened a business like that, but you're getting ready to. Nobody has started an organization like that, but you're getting ready to. Nobody in your family has graduated, but you're getting ready to. Nobody in your family has gone from an apartment and living in the basement to a $6 million mansion, but tell somebody what you're getting ready to. Y'all don't believe that. So because he was a righteous man, almost done here, the Bible says that he found favor in the sight of God. The Bible says that he found favor in God. And you don't get favor just having any kind of lifestyle. Favor comes with a certain life of living for the Lord. That's why we've got to be very careful as pastors and preachers and leaders that we don't give blanketed prophecies to people who are not living for the Lord. Because if I prophesy favor in this room, it's not for everybody. It's for the righteous that make up their decision that I'm not perfect, but every day I'm going to do my best to live for God. Tell somebody that's what's for me. Tell them that's what's for me. So what happens is we prophesy to the church and then people get mad when it doesn't show up in their life. But what are you living in your life? He found favor because of his dikaiosune, his equity of character. That's what got him blessed. I cannot prophesy to you a new home if you don't have the character to manage the one you're in. I cannot prophesy to you a new job if you are not properly stewarding and tithing with the money you have now. Y'all don't like that kind of talking because y'all think that it's a giveaway every Sunday. You get a car and you get a house and you get a blessing. No, it's for the righteous. That's why the Bible said the righteous cry out. And the Lord, not the negligent, not the unaccountable, not those that don't have integrity, but the righteous. And I need to break down, I keep saying that word, equity of character, because many times what the church has done is made it feel like righteousness is something we can't obtain. It's so far away. How can I be righteous? I gotta be so holy. I gotta be so perfect. Oh my shay. But it's just the equity of your character. It's the fact that every day I really want to be the best me. And when I mess up, I'm willing to say I messed up. When I've offended somebody, I'm willing to say I offended somebody. There's a lot of church people going to hell. This message is going a whole other way. I haven't even gotten to my point. There's a lot of church people going to hell. Because we have got, I done got mad. Because we are getting this thing wrong. Think that righteousness is the deepness of our bless you. I'm at church every Sunday. I serve on the elder board. I know Greek and Hebrew. And will have your Greek and Hebrew burning in hell. Because you don't know how to stop offending people. Because you don't know how to apologize. Because you don't know that even though you think it's helping, you are a gossiper. I come to free. Am I doing all right, Nisi? Okay, you got me? All right. Righteousness is not a look. It is not the way you sit in your seat. It is not the collar you have on. It's who are you when you're driving home by yourself. Who are you when you get in that group text message? How I got out here, I don't know. Who are you? Look at your name and say, who are you anyway? I'm going to have to break this up in two parts. I haven't even got to the points yet. The builder's anointing. He had equity of character. He had good character. He had good morals. He had good integrity. So what did that do? It released something in his life. We are striving for the wrong thing. We're striving for approval, striving for people to notice us and recognize us. And what do you see in me? And who do I need to be? And where do I need to be? And who will celebrate me? And it's this demon of social media that has brought it to a whole other level. Because we've become hungry and addicted to approval and comparison. And we've forgotten that all of that, half of those people you see ain't even living what you see them posted. So we've lost the fact that what God wants in us is he wants us to have good character. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, say how you treat me is going to help you get into heaven. You can't lift your hands next to me and not speak to me. And think that God, am I talking good? And think that this message has gone off the rails, so I apologize. And think that, it's amazing to me how people think that you can have an alt with somebody and lift your dirty hands and think that God is going to receive that. That's a mess. And this is the place that the church has gotten to. We have made this righteousness thing so, as my grandmother would say, so heavenly bound that it's no earthly good. But I'm not righteous because of how well I know the Bible. I'm righteous because I love my neighbor. I'm righteous because I steward my money according to his word. I'm righteous because every day when I mess up, I have enough conviction to say, Lord, help me get it right tomorrow. We living in this weird world where we have no conviction. We can cuss driving up in the pulpit in the parking lot and get here and lift our hands and feel just fine about it. Peter was a cusser, right? Don't we use the Bible? Oh, God, okay. Whew. Don't judge me, judge yourself. No, we are judging you. My proud student. Say it in the mic so the people could hear you.
With righteous judgment.
Tell somebody, judge me righteously. What? Judge me with my dakayosune. Judge me with the equity of my character. Let me talk to you. You're not accountable. Let me talk to you. You need to work on your integrity. What's the integrity? Do what you say you're going to do. Oh, I'm trying. See, y'all thought this righteousness was cherubims and seraphims. Cry holy. It's righteousness. Right? But it's these things. This is how you find favor with God. Not that you're perfect, not that you always get it right, but when I do mess up, I'm so convicted I can't continue until I get it right. Somebody just lay hands and say, Lord, put that conviction back in me. Put it, don't let me sleep at night till I get it right. That is where Noah was. I'm gonna stop. I'm gonna have to get into the next part. Come back next week, please. I'm going to give you. Oh, I won't be here. Y'all come back, but I will be ministering out of town. But still come back. It's gonna be a good time. I promise you. Amen. I'm going to give you when I get back the week after, I'm gonna give you three things that you've got to do in order to receive the builder's anointing. Because some of you are getting ready to do something great. One of the greatest, Mother Young, one of the greatest grievances, I know you'll agree with this, Overseer, one of the greatest grievances of a leader, of a pastor, is to pastor people who are afraid to tap into their full potential. It's one of the greatest grievances because the Lord gives leaders a grace to be able to see those who they have care of and see their potential and help to pull that out of them. And so it sometimes becomes a struggle because many times we see in you what you may not, one, either see in yourself or you've seen, you've just been too afraid to activate. So what the Lord wants to do is he wants to give you an anointing to build. See, one of the reasons that we are often fearful of building is because we think it's out of our own strength. We think that we've got to have the plan. I'll give you a prime example that even as a preacher, I was telling this to our homiletics class, that even as a preacher, the Lord will give me a message, but then the anointing has to come on that message. So then God begins to do the work. You all, a lot of things I do seem humorous, but in the spirit, it's a confirmation of you. You'll hear me sometimes when I'll preach, I say, oh, I feel the anointing. I feel the Lord kick into that message, move in that message. And that's what the Lord wants to do for many of you. I'm going to go back to what I said in the beginning. I promise you we will get back to this, but I want to get you out in good time. I want to say this to you. What you're getting ready to build is not just going to be new to you. It's going to be new to the world. Now, the response that we got is mixed because for many of you, we've got to spend time breaking down who other people told you you are. So it's hard for you to even receive what I'm saying because it seems like it's so far-fetched. It's so far away. But it's as simple as starting a cleaning business and cleaning a way that's never been cleaned before. Let me make it simple for you. It's not that you're going to build a spaceship. It's that the Lord's going to give you an anointing in something that you're already skilled to do, but you're going to do it in a new way. Do y'all hear what I'm saying? Do y'all hear what I'm saying to y'all? He's going to utilize a skill that's already in you because many of you, oh my God, many of you, the skill that you have, if you really tap into it, you would be a millionaire three times over. I'm not going to say your name because I know she'll get me afterwards, so I'm not going to let her get me. But I, the Lord confirmed this message, and they don't even know the Lord confirmed it. The Lord confirmed it in someone who came this week to the church and just had a burden to clean the church. Just had a passion just to come in and to clean and did it with such vigor, did it with such grace. And the Lord said to me, that's what God's going to do, and that's what I want you to tell the people. He's going to use their passion to push them into their next level. It's going to be something that you just think you're just doing. Oh, I just bake cakes. And people say, people are telling you that it's going to change your life. They say things like this, oh my God, this cake is so good. Oh my God, you got to give me the recipe for that cake. It's an indication. See, we hear these things, but we don't realize that God has looked at our dikaiosune. Don't that sound good? And coupled it with something that's already in us. To say, I'm going to use you in a way that you've never been used before. Now, for some of you, it's going to be something you've never done before. It's going to be something you've never done. It's going to be something so simple, like Apostle comes up to you and says, you know what? I want you to sing the sermonic solo. You'd be saying, I know he lying. I know he is lying. And you get up there and open your mouth and deliverance happens in the room. Because of your dikaiosune, your character, watch this, to be obedient even when you're scared. Look at somebody say, do it afraid. See, that's what gets you blessed. That's what you get, and that's why God puts leaders in your life to pull something out of you that you may say, I don't want to lead prayer this morning. And somebody gets a breakthrough. Somebody gets healed. Somebody gets delivered. It's our equity of character. That's where the builder's anointing starts. Your obedience. When God speaks, you got to listen. Many of you, it happens to you all the time. God speaks to you. You've got a passion for women. Women who've been in domestic violence. Women who've been broken. And you've got this passion. It's burning you. Start this organization. Just go, you know, start a Facebook group. And you keep talking yourself out of it. I can't start no Facebook group. I don't know nothing about social media. Learn it. Sorry. Excuse me. Somebody say, learn it. I'm going to the end. We're going to stand. We're going to lift our hands, cry a little bit. Then we're going to go home. Noah had to follow the plan. He didn't know anything about building an ark, man. He didn't know anything about building an ark. But he was obedient because of his dikaiosune, his character. He said, Lord, I don't know, but I trust you. And watch this. And because I say I trust you, I'm going to show you I trust you. See, we say, oh, we're great at saying it. If you will only, I trust you, Lord. I trust you, Father. Okay. Go to that nursing home and start a Bible study. Oh, you trust me? Okay, start that business. Oh, you trust me? Tell Apostle, put me in homiletics class. I want to deliver the word of God. Did y'all feel that in there? God wants to get us to that place where we trust him in whatever he says, because he needs some more people who will stand up in the uniqueness of who he wants them to be. There'll be no blueprint. Look at your neighbor and say, there'll be no blueprint. There'll be no YouTube video that you can look at. There'll be no master class you can attend. There'll be no mentor. He will be the mentor. He will be the mentor. Noah couldn't go. Well, they didn't have YouTube, but if they did, Noah couldn't go on there. No, the Lord said, I want you to make it. Come on, overseer said it. This many cubits. I want you to put this in there. Can I just tell y'all this and then we go home? Noah lived 100 miles from the closest ocean. He wasn't even near water. They don't hear me, honey. There had been no rain in sight. So he had to look crazy. He was 500. It took him, the Bible says, it took him 120 years. He was 500 years old when he built the ark. He was 600 when the rain came. So for 100 years, he had to look crazy. He had to keep on building something, and there was no rain in sight. What you doing, Noah, building an ark? What you building an ark for? What you starting a business for? We in a pandemic. I'm building, though. For 100 years, he had to build something, and there was no sign. There was no confirmation. There was no confirmation, but he kept on building. See, what we do is we need the confirmation first. I need 50 followers, and then I'll start. I see people do, you know social media, people do all the time when they get online. Hey, y'all, I'm going to go live. I'm going to just wait till 20 more people get on here. Just come on. I ain't going to be on here long. And then you say, y'all know I don't do this often, so y'all come on in here. Am I right? Just wait for 20 more people. No, we don't want you to wait. I'm the one, and I need it now. I don't have time to wait for you to get your numbers up. What you gonna say? This is where God wants to stand to your feet. I apologize. I am only in the introduction, so we will have to come back. Your dikaiosune matters. Your equity of character. God does not need another preacher who can hoop in four different keys. He has enough of those. He has enough of those. He does not need another worship leader who can do all the riffs and runs. We have enough of those. He needs some people who are focused on the equity of character. And it's important that as the body of Christ, we recognize and accept that, because there is, I've been saying this for about 3 or 4 years now, there is a paradigm shift in the kingdom of God. There's a paradigm shift, and God is not using who the church has been comfortable with. He's not using the one that knows the church jargon and has done this for years and knows how to do protocol and knows all these things that we focus on. He's going to use the one who has the kaiosune, who has the right character. I'm going to say something, and it's almost an indictment. I'm a part of the ecclesia, the called out, but I'm going to say it. It's unfortunate that what we're seeing, Minister Vadine, in this era of church, is there is more character in the audience than there is in the pulpit. There's more integrity out here, because people are making, that's why people don't want to come to church, because we're making a mess of this. Because we can preach good, but we in all kinds of scandals. We can preach good, but we're taking the church's money. Not this pastor. Huh, the devil's a liar. We good? Everybody's all right? Okay. We can preach good, but we beat on our wives. Testify loud, honey. Amen. That ain't me. Praise the Lord. Okay. If anything, it'd be the other way around. There's more character out here. And God is tired of this being abused. He's tired of this being used for ego. So now he's exposing the corruption and pulling those out here that say, I was drunk last night, but Lord, if you hear me, I'll say what you want me to say. I just got out of jail a year ago, but I'm ready to change my life and be who he needs me to be. And the church don't like that, though, because we need to package a certain way. It's got to walk a certain way, got to talk a certain way, got to look a certain way. The kaiosune is what God wants. He wants the equity of our character. Yes. He said, man looks on the outside. God looks on the inside. And so now we as a church, we got to be accepting to that. We got to receive people who don't look like the church, but have the heart of the church. That's why y'all see in this church, we have our leaders sit up front, but anybody can say, they say, oh, you're not an elder, move. No, you want God and you got a heart, come sit here. Sit on the stage if you want. That's the stuff we got to break up. That pleases us here, but it's not pleasing him there. Moses found favor because of his character. He was okay with being different. No, I know I don't want to be in the group chat. We may not, can I use me as an example? We may not like what Apostle did, but I ain't going to be in that conversation. I'll dislike it by myself. Don't y'all get quiet. Please talk to me in here. Yeah, we got a family issue. Yeah, we got a friendship issue. But I'll deal with it on my own. I'm not going to be a part of the conversation. That's what character is. Character is how we deal with things, how we handle things, who we are. Get out your seat. Find somebody. Say, God wants your dakaiosune. Come on, come on. Move quickly. Come on, come on, come on. Get out of your suit. Come on, get out of your seat. Tell him. Tell him God wants your character. You want to build. You want to be successful. You want to be prosperous. You got to work on that character. You want to have favor with God. You got to work on your character. The real you. I said the real you. That's what God wants from us, church. Everyone is aspiring for their next, aspiring to be the next. We all want success. Nothing wrong with that. We all want wealth. Nothing wrong with that. But what profit a man to gain the world and lose his soul? Which is connected to his what? The kaiosune. The soul is the seat of your heart. Y'all remember when I preached about the three consciousness that we have? The soul. It's the seed of that. That's where your character comes from. This is what God wants. I'm going to pray a prayer for you today. I apologize that we didn't get to the rest. Pray that you got something out of this. My commitment to this church, my commitment to Rhema, my commitment to Hope City, my commitment to City Dwellers International Assembly is to help you be people of good character. That is my commitment to you. That is our commitment to you. That when you come here, you don't just get something that makes you feel good, make your ears itch, makes you think and say, you know what, that's a part of me I need to work on. That's a part of me I need to change. It didn't feel good when he said it, but it's an indication that's something I need to work on. That's our commitment to you. Not for this to be a church that's a talent school. Come and learn how to sing. Come and learn how to dance. Come on, you can be an elder. You can be a pastor. No. Guess what? Because we got to make an account for what we did as a part of your life. And I can teach you. I can give you skills. My background as an entrepreneur, I can tell you how to build a business. I can tell you how to allocate streams of income. But if you're not a person of good character, it doesn't mean a thing. So that's what we're going to work on in this season as a ministry, making sure we're people of good character and making sure that we're not so haughty that we think the message is for everybody else. It ain't for me. I know about good character. I done heard that before. You need to hear it again. So that you can continue to be that person. Because watch this. Character does not put you on an exempt list. Listen to what I'm saying to you. And then I'm going to pray. Character does not, it's not like a rebate. I'd have had good character for the last 15 years. I'm good. And then you get into one mistake and ruin all of that. I often say, see, we think that God has like this, well, you know what? You were saved for the first 15 years of your life. You're good. No, you got to keep on being saved. It don't matter what you did 10 years ago. It don't matter what you did yesterday. You could be righteous yesterday and sin today and still go to hell. I got to give y'all the truth. I'm sorry. It doesn't matter that you're here today. If you leave here tomorrow and go steal somebody's money and don't ask for repentance, guess what?
You are going to hell.
She said it, not me. So that's our commitment to you all, to make you people of good character so that we can all make heaven our home. Look at your brother, look at your sister, say, I want to see you in heaven. When I get there, I want to be like, there go Pastor Belton. Hey, Pastor. Hey, Minister Donna. Amen. Grab the hand of somebody next to you. Father, we thank you for this word. Lord, I had a plan, but you had a plan. And so I said what you wanted me to say. And I pray that somebody today would be impacted in a way that would create life transformation. That as we leave this place, Father, all of us, me included, we would leave here and look at our dikaiosune. Look at the equity of our character. Not what we just present to man, but how you see us. And if there's anything in us, Lord, that needs to be changed, anything that needs to be refined, anything that needs to be blotted out, burned out, so that we can be people of good character. We don't want houses and no integrity. We don't want great jobs and no morality. But we want to live according to your word. Help us to be who you want us to be. In Jesus' name, we say it is so, and it will not be reversed. Come on, clap your hands and give God praise. Come on, if you receive that word, clap your hands. Pray that you